Wow, what an awesome night tonight. Joshua chapter 22 is the main text, and the other ones don't really need to turn to, because I'm just going to refer to them, not actually read them. Something jumped out this week, and I want to say something about that. I'm starting the Word, and then we're going to get into a couple other thoughts that came about, and I have a lot of the stuff written down already. The scriptures I don't have written down in full, they're just marked on here. And those are just Joshua 7, Joshua 22, and Numbers 25. Those are the only three that are the main ones to look at. Joshua 22, Joshua 7, and Numbers 25. Things that are being referred to in here, and then several other powerful thoughts as well. So let me get turned over. Yeah, here I am. And yeah, a little bit of changes in the home, so had to really stand up to truth this week, and it was very difficult. It was a long decision I had to make, and factoring in all my responsibilities and whatnot, it caused me to make a pretty quick decision, but I know it was right, and I feel like now on Saturdays, it's just gotten that much better. I haven't felt that feeling, and I literally forgot it existed. It was such a relief to feel like I got the home to myself in the Saturday morning. It was just really nice. It felt like this was more like what I'm supposed to be doing. And so, God take over the future. It's in His hands. This is His church. And I wanted to clarify something I said last time during the discussion time, and that was that I said that I love this unction in this church, and I really do. And I said it was the best in the world, and I know that sounds kind of funny, but what I mean by that is that it's gotten to the point where I am today and where I'm going is that the original point of all my recordings has become one of my most important things to me, is that I literally don't take credit for it. I've heard people like Gail Ripplinger. I talked to her on the phone, and I just said, thank you so much for what you do. And she said, it's so the Lord. And she really means it too. I mean, even though she worked so hard on it, even though she suffered so much for it, but anybody who's ever moved in a real anointing long enough to be wise to never touch the glory of it. And I am so sure of it, and I am so confident in it that I watch it and I'm like, and it literally restores me to my vision that I believe is the best. And I'm going to touch on a few things that's going to really, really cut the mustard as far as like making that dividing line utterly clear for those that are really, really want to go all the way with the Lord and they're not there. They say, I'm not all the way with the Lord, but I want to go all the way from here on out. The truth be prevailing in my heart for real, for real. Amen. And I am not okay with the mindset of I found it and let's just continue on while talking big, but truly being ready for the changes that God wants to bring. And if Christ is going to say that, let thy will be done, then I believe the Christians who follow him are going to follow in those kinds of footsteps to do that which you don't actually want to do, but to see yourself follow through with what the voice of the Holy Spirit is actually saying. And I believe that is going to be the kingpin of what God's true church is all about. And there's a lot of other things going on that God can use. Amen. That really God can use. I was watching Chuck Missler today talking about house churches, and he had nothing but good things to say about it. He says, that's more the church than the big, gigantic things. He says, I'm not opposed to them. He's not condemning them at all. But he says, that's not really what the church is. He says, that house churches is really where it's at. There, and he has a long list of things. He says, this is where you can interact, you can be yourself. There's no real, like, hey, he's the big chief and everybody else is the follower of that person. He says, no, that's not really what the church is all about. There's one guy kind of overseeing it or whatever, and there's some kind of like an order to it, but at the same time, everybody is a participator in it compared to a spectator sport, which can cause people to be extremely spiritually weak and depending so much on people and not so much upon the Holy Spirit, which is what the church is all about, amen? And so we're going to get into a few things that relate to this and the cruciality and the very seriousness of the New Testament church, and to remember how much the thing that matters so much is the thing that is not easily seen. And so that tone, that old-fashioned tone, I hear it in a lot of preaching, a lot of old preaching, and it's pretty deep, it's pretty weighty, and I see eye to eye with that. And so as they influence me, I feel like the anointing that God is doing, against my will. I mean, I'm glad for him to do whatever he wants, but it isn't easy, and I'm going with it. It's looking a lot like that. It's looking like that. It's feeling like that to me. And it's really, really exciting, and it feels really, really good right now. It doesn't always feel like that. Sometimes it feels like prison. Sometimes I feel like Paul saying, I'm in chains. I'm a bond servant to Christ. I'm a slave to Christ. I say, brother, I can relate to at least a piece of it, because I know I have never touched what these touch, but I'm feeling another sight that I feel like I'm getting another authority to take things to a level where I was fearful before, and I don't feel fearful anymore to certain things of being able to stand up for the Lord in places that is a pretty large scale arena, and it's getting really, really exciting to see that happen. And though some things don't seem to ever change, stuff is changing, and God is moving. He's breathing upon this ministry, and I'm clear on it, and I'm very, very excited about it, and fearful because of things we're going to be looking at today to see how challenges can happen. There's a few lessons that I want to look at today in Joshua 22 that came out, and I said, now that's a good point. Joshua 22 is the main text for the initial thought, but there's a whole lot of other stuff that still a little bit relates to what we've been talking about, which is true spiritual warfare, biblical spiritual warfare, as opposed to the view from a church falling into apostasy and their view of spiritual warfare, which is pretty much what the last few decades is what we've pretty much heard. And not enough of the true spiritual warfare, which I am crystal clear on. And I'm kind of lay it down with an iron hammer and just say, kapoom, that's what it says, and that's what it is. And that's where we need to keep our sights on, to know where our enemy is, to know how to handle it properly, to have it all balanced out in our mind that we are not going to get deceived. We're not going to get tossed around thinking, oh, this devil's over here doing this and all that stuff. Never mind that. We have a much bigger fish to fry. When in doubt, we're going forward to say, this is truth, and I know who's trying to stop the church from being what she's supposed to be, to advance the way she's supposed to be. I know it totally, and I'm against it totally, and I'm going to continue to stand there and say the same thing over and over and over as the enemy continues to say the same thing over and over and over, and their voice in this world is far, far louder. But when the light does shine in the midst of that loud darkness, how bright that light is, amen. And today was a really good example of that. I was talking to someone who was picking on me. And instead of returning fire, because I could tell they were trying to be mean to me, and I just said, hi, how are you? And where are you from? Or something like that. And they said, well, you know what? I was about ready to tear you up, but since you were being friendly with me, I changed my mind. And then I continued to be friendly and talking about things that I just think is nice to talk about. And it got even further where a person who is dead serious about their witchcraft is said, you've earned my respect. And it caused me to see this again, okay? Now, among the gay community, now of the witchcraft community, you see people going into certain type of mindsets because they've been through a lot, and they grabbed a hold of whatever came along, and they said, this is what I am, and they have identity, and they have a way to look at things, and they have a way to protect themselves, like armor against the hurt of the world, you know? A lot of times those are Christians because they're full of the devil. A tremendous amount of Christians are not safe to be around. They're legalistic or they're liberal, whichever kind of letter they follow, but it's still not of the Holy Spirit. The letter kills, the Spirit gives life, amen? So, I'm recognizing once again that the folks out there that might have their finger against the church, they don't got their finger against the church, they got their finger against that which is of the devil, then calls itself the church, amen? They hate the devil just as much as anybody does, and then if it comes and says, I'm Jesus, they start to say, I hate Jesus, and I hate all their followers, because all their experience has all been bad. And I can understand that. I said, hey, I understand. There's a lot of sin in the churches, and how can you possibly get anything good from someone who's walking in darkness and falling into one of the worst demonic traps you could ever fall into, half and half Christianity? You never know what you're going to get. You're not going to get the glory of God. Amen? So, lots of little things going on today. Really, really powerful word tonight. I'm really, really excited. I believe it's solid and true. This jumped out at me, and the first thing that came to my mind in Joshua 22, I'm going to go through it, pretty much the whole thing, then I'll come back and tag it a little bit again. But I'm going to, I'll pray and ask the Lord to be with us, and then we'll look at Joshua 22, probably most of the chapter. It's a little bit much, but that's okay. Heavenly Father, we adore you in this house, Lord God. And we need you more than we need the air that we breathe, Lord God. For you alone are our rock, Lord God. As you move, as you make clear vision, Lord God, you keep us sustained as new creatures in Christ. that need eternal sustenance, Lord God, and you have been our portion. You have been our joy. You have been our strength, Lord. And we are grateful for you. We honor you. We lift your name high in your house, Lord, on this day to separate our minds from our responsibilities, but to an eternal responsibility to gather with the brethren, to lift your name above everything else, Lord God, because you are above everything else. And it just feels so good to be around a place that's going to lift your name to its rightful place, Lord God. So we give you the glory in this house. We give you the honor. And we come with a grateful heart to say, Lord, we need you. And we're coming to ask you, Lord, put a revival in this little room today. And put a revival in our hearts today. Cause great things to be seen, Lord God, that your eternal will may be done in the most perfect way and by your glorious leading of the Holy Spirit. May Jesus get glory in this house today. Amen. Then Joshua called the Reubenites and the Gadites and the half tribe of Mannasseh. That's the scripture you see on the board there. There's two main keys, verse 1 and also verse 10. So Joshua is talking to three folks: Reubenites, Gadites, and Mannasseh, ultimately, okay? And what you're going to remember about these guys right here, it's going to say how faithful they are and how obedient they have been, and they're going to get something special. Verse 2 says, And said unto them, ye have kept all that Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, and have obeyed my voice in all that I commanded you. So right there you see that they're totally obedient for the last two kingpins, patriarchs, Moses, the heavy hitter, and Joshua, really, really heavy hitter too. And they've been faithful to the two leaders as God is leading. Verse 3 says, ye have not left your brethren these many days unto this day, but have kept the charge of the commandment of the Lord your God. And now the Lord your God hath given rest unto your brethren as he promised them. Therefore now return ye and get you unto your tents and unto the land of your possession, which Moses the servant of the Lord gave you on the other side Jordan. But take diligent heed to do the commandment and the law which Moses, the servant of the Lord, charged you, to love the Lord your God, and to walk in all his ways, and to keep his commandments, and to cleave unto him, and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul. So Joshua blessed them and sent them away, and they went unto their tents. Now to one half of the tribe of Mannasseh Moses had given possession in Bashan, but unto the other half thereof gave Joshua among their brethren on this side Jordan westward. And when Joshua sent them away also unto their tents, then he blessed them. And he spake unto them, saying, return with much riches unto your tents, and with very much cattle, with silver and with gold, and with brass and with iron, and with very much raiment. Divide the spoil of your enemies with your brethren. The children of Reuben and the children of Gad and the half tribe of Mannasseh returned and departed from the children of Israel out of Shiloh, which is in the land of Canaan, to go unto the country of Gilead, to the land of their possession whereof they were possessed, according to the word of the Lord by the hand of Moses. Okay, now here's verse 10, which is on the screen as well. I have it in green, I think. And when they came unto the borders of Jordan, okay, now this is the three faithful guys, and these guys are being directed for something special. They are in the land of Canaan, the children of Reuben, Gad, half-tribe of Mannasseh, those three again, okay? Built there an altar by Jordan, a great altar to see to. Okay, now that's the clincher right there of kind of what's going on right now. As these faithful guys are being dealt with by the leadership, they built an altar. And this is where I kind of got mixed up in a little bit here, thinking that this was a bad deal because of the way everybody's responding. So let's see how the leadership responds after this happens. Verse 11 says, and the children of Israel heard say, behold, the children of Reuben, the children of Gad, and the half-tribe of Mannasseh have built an altar over against the land of Canaan in the borders of Jordan at the passage of the children of Israel. When the children of Israel heard of it, the whole congregation of the children of Israel gathered themselves together at Shiloh to go up to war against them. And the children of Israel sent unto the children of Reuben and to the children of Gad and to the half-tribe of Mannasseh into the land of Gilead Phinehas, son of Eleazar the priest. Anybody remember that Phinehas guy? Mm-hmm. Amen. He's good with the spear, right? And with him 10 princes of the chief house of the prince of throughout all the tribes of Israel, and each one was an head over the house of fathers among thousands of Israel. So you got Phinehas, who's one of the chiefs right now, and then 10 other major kingpins that are over a lot of people, coming to visit these three groups because they built this altar, and they're like, what in the world are you doing? So check and see what they say here. 15 says, and they came unto the children of Reuben, Gilead, saying, 16, thus saith the whole congregation of the Lord, what trespass is that ye have committed against the God of Israel, to turn away this day from following the Lord, and that ye have builded you an altar, that ye might rebel this day against the Lord? Is the iniquity of Peor too little for us, from which we are not cleansed until this day, although there was a plague in the congregation of the Lord? Which, remember, that plague happened. That's when Phinehas is also, during the time, God released his judgment against the people, and he backed down because of Phinehas' anger against the fornicators, okay? So, and he's saying, the leaders are like coming to these people like, dude, you built this altar? Isn't this following not the Lord? And haven't we learned from Peor? Isn't that bad enough? And we haven't even recovered from that radical plague that God put upon us and killed 25,000 people. Isn't that bad enough? Why are we acting like this? Verse 18, but it says, but that ye must turn away this day from following the Lord. Are you crazy, kind of thing? And it will be seen that ye rebel today against the Lord, that tomorrow he will be wroth with the whole congregation of Israel. You know how God kind of says, okay, I saw what you did. Now tomorrow let's talk. And so they're like, why are you doing this to us? We're still not even recovered from the first beating. What are you doing? 19, that notwithstanding in the land of your possession be unclean, then pass ye over unto the land of the possession of the Lord, wherein the Lord's tabernacle dwelleth, and take possession among us, but rebel not against the Lord, nor rebel against us, in building you an altar beside the altar of the Lord our God. And here's another warning. Remember how he's like, hey, what about Baal Peor? And now he's saying, did not Achan, the son of Zerah, commit a trespass in the accursed thing, and wrath fell on all the congregation of Israel, and that man perished not alone in his iniquity? Remember how he got busted and all his animals and all his whole family? I mean, it was such a big deal. And so these guys are seriously like, seriously, guys, what are you doing? Then the children of Reuben, the children of Gad, and the children of Mannasseh, those are the main characters right now, the peoples, and those are the faithful ones, and they did something that didn't seem right. Said unto the heads of the 10,000s, those 11 people, the Lord, this is interesting, verse 22, watch this one. It says, the Lord God of gods, the Lord God of gods, two times. And what we know in the scripture, when it says something two times, or even three, which is only holy, 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 is the emphasis in how they say it. The Lord God of gods, it's like a double emphasis. He knoweth, and Israel he shall know, if it be in rebellion, or if it be transgression against the Lord, save us not this day. So you can see the difference there. He says, God will let us know now. Is this us rebelling, or are we just making a big mistake? Well, let us explain. That we have built us an altar to turn from following the Lord, or if to offer thereon burnt offering, or meat offering, or if to offer peace offerings thereon, let the Lord himself require it. And if we have not rather done it for fear of this thing, saying in time to come to your children, might speak unto our children, saying, what have ye to do with the Lord God of Israel? For the Lord hath made Jordan a border between us and you, ye children of Reuben and children of Gad. Ye have no part in the Lord, so shall your children make our children cease from fearing the Lord. Therefore we said, let us now prepare to build us an altar, not for burnt offering, nor for sacrifice. 27 says, but that it may be a witness between us and you and our congregations after us, that we might do the service of the Lord before him with our burnt offerings and with our sacrifices and with our peace offerings, that your children may not say to our children in time to come, ye have no part in the Lord. So he's protecting even the future generations of the people of God, have something to look back and have it be a testimony or something that may be a witness between us. This isn't something that's supposed to be us turning away from God. This is a compliment. We mean this to be a good thing, for to look back. And then you see the leadership backing down. Verse 30 says, and when Phinehas the priest and the priests of congregation, heads of the 10,000s, which with her heard the words that the children of Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh, it pleased them. See, I didn't finish this earlier on, so this week I actually made a video talking about all these different hang-ups. I'm like, you see all these people, they never get it, and how when they sinned over here, it was not just them, it was more, and how bad it was, and I didn't finish the chapter. It's like one of my things I've been preaching against for years is Christians who don't finish the chapter of what they're reading to get the true context of it. But needless to say, I was very happy after I did finish it that it turned out to be a good thing, for which is great, for the Old Testament is full of a lot of really serious error among God's people and bringing great distress to God's heart, and a lot of judgment come even against his own people. So it's really, really cool to see something that looked wrong be not wrong. So there was just so many interesting things. This story never really stuck out to me before. And so now that it has, it brought up a lot of points that I just talked about it for like over half an hour this week on the video. And now I'm going to do it again as we just looked at it. But you can see what I'm saying, that it's cool how they came up to them. The leadership came to the people and then they requested it. They even brought their great concern. This is a sin. Haven't you seen enough sin before? We know how bad it's been. A lot of people have been dying. God's judgment, he's going to be wroth with us. And then they found out, oh, explanation of the altar, it's a good deal. So it kind of helped me kind of close the door to just like being so quick to have a final decision when it comes to the needs of other people. It's going to be a much wiser way to handle people. Not that you're going to back down on your convictions, but to just say, we know what we're doing, this doesn't look right, and kind of make sure you bring up the subject in the right time to be able to handle something that just doesn't seem right, you know. So part of it right there. Had a conversation with a Christian this week, and judging a lot by what we've been seeing in the scripture today, or this last month, I think of like January 2016 as a mostly, like I said before, true spiritual warfare, actual biblical spiritual warfare, to show us where our target is and where is the conflict at. God's will among God's people versus the will of the world, which are never in, which they're never in unison. They're always in conflict. They're not together on their overall will, you know. And so sometimes there's a way that looks like they're together, but when you really boil it all down, they're not, and they never are to be, because the spirit of the world, ultimately, spiritually especially, is not in harmony with God's will. It's not according to God's laws. And it's a whole other vision altogether. They have a whole different means of how they want to rule and things like that. And it's not in light. Okay, so granted that, if you think of someone who says, I am a Christian, I am born again of the Spirit of God, and I love Jesus, I would do anything he says, year after year, the same confession, the same style of church, the same amount of devotion, no different sacrifices, nothing else. Still so much like the world. And then when this truth comes to this mindset and say, Robbie, I know that you have your mindset on these big enemies and people doing things in darkness and having such an effect on the world, and it doesn't bother me. And my thoughts is like, well, the Bible says they're supposed to. This is where we're supposed to wrestle. What do you wrestle? We're not supposed to wrestle against flesh and blood, and maybe you don't do that, but we are supposed to wrestle against them. Because they're trying to do something against the will of the God we say we're serving. I don't understand how that's not clear. I know it's not clear to most people because we've been believing a stronghold that isn't true. Most Christians do believe that scripture in a very, very wrong way. And they get nothing done. That's the hamster wheel of going around in circles, wearing themselves out, getting nothing done. Telling all every devil what to do instead of telling the leadership, we're not going to allow you to push us that far. You can lead however you want to, but as soon as you start commanding us outside of God's will, now we're going to have to make sure that the resistance is utterly clear. Amen. And that's where heads start rolling, because the church is being true to the God who they are, who really is. They're being true to him in spirit, okay? Because the darkness that the people rule in is, they rule in darkness, spiritual wickedness. They're spiritual wickedness, okay? But we are not spiritual wickedness as born-again Christians. If you really are born again, you're spiritual righteousness. You got the righteousness of Christ upon you. You have the newness of life. And the Holy Spirit is your guide. Truly the Holy Spirit is your guide. And he will not allow you to be in spiritual union with the rulers of the world. You have to obey them in the natural, but spiritually there's going to be a conflict. And if they ever push too far, Christians can't just say, oh, who cares? There is no who cares when it comes to spiritual light from heaven and spiritual wickedness. They don't agree. We're going this way. No, we're not. That's too far. There is resistance. If they want to push hard enough where they finally say either resist or to change your ways, or heads are going to roll. I guess heads are going to roll because we're not changing. That's how come heads roll. That's what the Inquisitions were all about. That's what it's about in so many different sections of history, is because the people wanted to rule in spiritual wickedness. They wanted to bring their spiritual wickedness to a forefront so strong that the people who were really of God couldn't follow anymore. Said, I want to obey your rules, but as soon as you cross the line of the Word of God, we're done following. That's why Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they would be willing to go into the fiery furnace because they wouldn't surrender to the powers changing their mind about how they're going to be truthful about the Word of God. They were in spiritual wickedness. They crossed the line. Daniel in the lion's den, same thing. I'm not going to bow down to anybody but the Lord. And don't tell me I can't pray to my God. That's crossing the line. That's spiritual wickedness, Brother Darius. I love you, but I love him more. And he has my total devotion from here until the last day I'm breathing. That will never change. Make that utterly plain. Change the law. I'm not changing my mind. I will die for my faith. That's what Christians really are. So when you hear people say, oh, those things, I don't care about all those people messing with our TVs or pumping junk into our kids. Ah, who cares? Ah, whatever. I'm like, they are doing what God says in his word that is going to destroy the church. And now we have a mixture, like I'm talking about last week. It's like, we don't want Satan's ideas about how to run a church. We have to go to where God is and say, there's nowhere to go but growth in God's church, in his economy. Meaning we give up more as he leads to go further with the Lord. We don't want Satan's ideas about how to run a church. And if we're going to allow the TV to be on, we're going to allow the commercials of perversion on, and allow the movies to be on, influencing us, it's going to desensitize us to the details of the leading of the Holy Spirit. Plain and simple, that's the world. Love not the world, the Bible says. Why do you love the world? Why isn't the enemy of the church your problem? It is God's problem. Why isn't it yours? Why are you in such symmetry with the enemy of God, and you still call yourself a Christian? I'm going to make it clear. I'll make it crystal clear right now. Christians don't have a problem being enemies with the enemy. If you don't have a problem being an enemy with the enemy, you are God's enemy. My church is popular. All kinds of people love it. Even atheists love it. The church that atheists love, God hates. Listen to this giant, one of the biggest preachers in America. His name is Joel Osteen. And his wife was talking, and this is one of those places that you definitely wish the woman would be quiet. But she was saying something that you would not believe. I mean, it was like way over the top, and I heard it with my own ears. And she says, oh, when you come to God's house to worship, you're not worshiping for God, you're doing it for yourself. God wants you to be happy. You're here to sing unto God for you, not for him. God just wants you to be, as long as you're happy, it's all right. And I'm saying, isn't that amazing? 1963, one of the greatest sermons that I've ever heard, ever preached, saying the happiness of man is humanism, and that we can't even ask for revival until we get back to Christianity. If the emphasis of your life is my happiness, you are a devil. You are a child of the devil. I don't care if you call it Jesus or not, you're not following Jesus, and you're not of the Spirit of God. You need to repent. You need to repent. Anybody who does interviews with Oprah Winfrey, don't listen to them. They are not true guides. You need to repent. That's why you still got all the rated R movies on your shelf, and you got all the false preachers, because they're of the same spirit. You need to repent. Quickly. You see the Lord dealing with the people of God in a much lighter issues than this. Causing people to be careless with their obedience to God. Will you follow not the Lord anymore? Will you cease to follow in the Lord? Do you not see how he creeps in? Tries to get into our souls? Does it not matter? Why is it that God says to wrestle against them and you say no problem? There is a problem, and it's not with God. His word is true. It's always said the same thing. He is God, and he's never going to change. Amen. And so when us as the people of God, God's enemies, is our enemies. Amen. God's enemies is our enemies. In a certain degree, make sure you hold all those pieces together so you don't lose your head and just go crazy. But in a holy way, we have our stance and it doesn't change. God first, everything else can wait. That's what the scripture is really teaching us. So that's a final on the spiritual warfare. I don't know if I'm going to bring it up anymore. I hope I can move on. But the thought there is the Lord's enemies thy enemies? It doesn't bother me the details of the conspirators. Well, Paris Reidhead says this is the betrayal of the ages, happiness of man. Doesn't God want us to be happy, he says? He says, yes, he does want us to be happy. But that is a byproduct and not a prime product. That is not the root of the tree for us to be happy. That is the fruit of the tree. That is the blossoming of the leaves or the branches of the tree. Christ, the solid rock, revealed to his people to be a new creature, a new heart will I give you, not of stone, but a heart of flesh, that you can be receiving things of the Lord. Amen. See, on the streets and on the line, atheists are so serious about mocking Jesus. They literally just think we're so stupid. And I'm like, let me ask you something, my friend. Have you ever met anybody who had no feeling in their hand? They could put their hand on the stove, and it doesn't mean anything to them because they don't feel it. There's not, their hand is dead to feeling. No feeling. And so they say, hey, you can put your hand right there. Nothing will go wrong. I don't feel nothing. Yeah, my hand's all jacked up, but I didn't feel it. No problem. You try it. Okay. And they could feel it before they even touch it. They're like, I'm not touching that thing. Why? Because you got feeling in your hand. Well, there's some people who have a spirit that hasn't been awakened. It's dead. They're spiritually dead. And they think they can tell me whether God is alive or not. I don't want to hear from someone who is spiritually dead. You have no feeling in your spirit. God has not turned your spirit open to receive of the things of God. The Father has not revealed his Son to you. You are a blind guide, whether you're atheist or you're not. If God has not revealed something to you from above, you're a blind guide and you cannot help anybody. You don't see the big picture. You're guaranteed to get something wrong as you're navigating through the Word of God. It's not for flesh, because natural man receiveth not the things of the spiritual book. Amen? So you're going to miss it on something. God wants to reveal his Son and make a people that is different, a peculiar people that is radically different than the people of this world who literally can't understand why we're like that, because our hand is not numb. We have our soul is not numb. Our spirit is not numb. The truths of God is like rain to our souls. To see things coming, to see the name of the Lord be lifted up, it's rain to our souls. We love to see him lifted up. We love to exalt him. We love to see his truth prevailing. We love to see his will being done and eyes being opened and awakened to his righteousness. It makes us so happy to see God get what he wants done. Amen. So it is not right for us. We need to be... Are we resisting the world or receiving the world? That's the question. Are we reaching the world or ignoring the world? So there's two different angles to that. How are they affecting us and how are we affecting them? Okay. First one is, are we resisting their influence or are we receiving their influence? Are we reaching them with our godly influence or ignoring the world and let them just go on their own way? See, that's what the church is today in a lot of ways. The world affects the church, and the church does not affect the world. That's Christianity in America. That's backwards for the way of the Lord. Okay, Christians are the ones to say, they're not going to get through us, but we are going to get through them. Amen. Totally opposite. We are going to invade all and fear none. Why? Because we are following God, the Holy Spirit, who happened to create the entire planet. He hovered over the face of the deep, and he's doing it right now over the depths of my soul, and I'm utterly confident to know that the CEO of the planet gave me authorization to share the word of the Lord with the world. Amen? So now we got one, I call it letters kill, but letter kills, letters kill, spirit giveth life, letter. Letter can be liberal or legalistic, okay? When we're in the letter, you can make the letter mean whatever you want it to. You can make it mean your own specific rule book. This is how we do it, and that's the only way, because that's what it says in the Bible. Like I said, but if you're not spiritually awakened, that's not true. Okay? Just like the Bible talks about those people trying to say, if you're not circumcised, you're not saved. And Paul's like, that ain't right. You don't know what you're talking about, okay? You got back into the letter here, okay? But the Spirit gives life, okay? We're supposed to be a people of grace, people who are saved by grace, okay? Not the law or the natural man. The natural man doesn't receive it, and the legalist doesn't receive it because they're both in the flesh. So you say the letter kills, Spirit gives life. You can be liberal and free to sin, or legalistic and not be living in sin, but you're still out of the grace of God. Either way, you're still not in the Spirit. So that's the problem right here. As you heard earlier, James White. Okay, James White is a very famous Calvinist preacher, Reformed preacher. And as I understand, not only was the Catholic Church giving a lot of grief to the true church, even when the Reformed Church started kicking into gear, they still had so much Catholic influence that they themselves were pretty heavy persecutors. Or not, I don't know about persecuting as far as killing, but they wouldn't smile upon house churches back then. There's a reason for that. But James White, anyway, as a Calvinist person, extremely smart guy, and I like him. I've heard him say one thing that I liked. He said that Michael isn't Jesus. I saw his video about that years ago, and I said, oh, finally, we agree on something. But other than that, he literally sounds like a Looney Tunes, okay? And he deserves to get hit extremely hard because he's a blatant liar against one of my heroes, and that's Gail Ripplinger. And I promised her, I talked to her on the phone, I said, I defend you. I've defended you for years, and I love you. I mean, we love you. You have impacted our lives tremendously. I feel Jesus with your preaching. I feel it's right. And even when she makes a mistake, she goes back and makes another video, says, this is where I erred in the book. This is not true. If we update it later on, it'll be different. But just so you know, that one's actually not true. Here's how it really is. Just a few corrections and being humble and honest. Check it out. I was working this week. I was out in Aurora a couple places, and across the street from one of the places I delivered lumber, across the street I saw the foundation of a home being built, and I saw all the wiring, and I saw the piping. Actually, I saw the piping, but in my mind I started seeing other things that I would imagine would have to be under there, like, you know, insulation and plumbing and wiring and just different things that would have to be under there before you continue to put on the floor, right? Well, I was thinking this thought in my mind. I imagined it because my mind is always going, thinking of ideas to help make the Word of God really easy to see. And this is what I see right here with James White. Okay, it's like someone's like, oh, I'm gonna build that floor, man. I'm gonna go get the best wood. I'm gonna nail it down shut with the best screws and make it look cool. Every little piece of wood, I'm gonna cut it up, make it look perfect, and just streamline. Awesome. All right, the plumber's coming over. Hey, where's that pipe that's coming out of the bottom here? There isn't any pipe coming down from the bottom there. I already just built the floor. We're done here. That's it. Who did you learn this from? Did you not learn this from someone who has any experience? Because there's a lot more to just the floor. And now as you build the floor, there's no way to get the wiring under there. How's the house going to be turned on? How are we going to connect it to the whole electrical system and PGE and whatever else? How are you going to connect it to the plumbing? How's it going to connect to the whole system? Well, I guess we're going to have to tear it up. Nope, don't touch it. You're wrong. You're all liars. Get away. This is fine. Right now, it's the way it is. And that's what James White is. You know, he builds himself up, realizes he's wrong. I mean, her book confounds him heavily. And she's telling the truth. And he's over there fighting her for years, 20 years. Had a debate when she didn't even know it was a debate. She just, like, they made it on the radio to say that they're interviewing her. And they made it into a debate later on, and she's like, that wasn't even what was going on. That wasn't what I didn't get the memo when I was on the radio. You know, trying to make her look stupid and stuff. I'm just like, that is just bad. And I read a lot of the stuff about him and other people, and I'm going to say it plainly. I don't want people to listen to him. He's wrong. And I didn't have to hear all this. I just watched him preach before, and I just felt, I'm like, this guy doesn't know what he's talking about. He's a letterhead. He's got his own idea about my legalistic ways. Now look at me, I'm the king. I got the floor all nice and smooth. Don't tell me it's wrong or I'll lie about you so no one will ever understand that I'm wrong. No, in the eyes of people is what you care about. If it was really about the eyes of God, you would repent, rip the floor out, and start all over. But because you're a lying, blind guide and a false accuser, you're ripping on a woman of God who's paid the price to do it right and has done far more work in that department than anybody else on the planet. So everybody else has the right to remain silent. If you don't like her, get off my page. Plain and simple. I defend her. It's not right. If anybody who's serving the Lord, they care about God. Sorry for getting so rough there. That's a big deal to me. And this has been going on for a really long time. And that's a big deal because he's very, very famous. So don't get mad at me for getting a little testy right there. That's a tough one for me. So got a little personal there. Forgive me. To be at peace in an earthly way, but an actual eternal disobedience. Why will we stay here when we see that we are wrong? Man switched from spiritual truth against their ego and puts it back into the letter of liberal or legal. And that's what happens when people start to fall into sin. All of a sudden, things don't matter anymore. Don't worry about those things anymore. Don't worry about that anymore. I mean, God understands. God doesn't care about that. God will get you through. And I've heard some of the best preachers switch. And I'm like, what happened? You just intimidated me because I could tell that I was listening to a prophet. And I feared that. You know, the Lord says, when you see something of a person that's not doing a specific thing, what they say doesn't come to pass, that's a false prophet, and you don't have to fear them. But when you know you're hearing from God in that moment, I do fear them. But when I see them switch and turn into the easy breezy, and I'm like, what happened? Where'd the fear go? Where'd the awe go? Where'd the respect? And after I got done listening to that, I had worldly music playing through my head, and I couldn't get it out because I tried to really take in the word. And that's one of the reasons why I'm just saying, look, I love everybody and every good thing that they do. I'll take it in, and then I will just make sure I don't breathe in that kind of stuff again, because that really messed me up pretty bad. But I will trust in the Lord directly, like the Bible shows us to. We don't need to have one gigantic hero. If there's someone out there that's done something great and they can benefit you sometimes, here and there, whenever they can, praise the Lord. But they're not Jesus, okay? They're not the Holy Spirit. God can be with them one day, and God could be off in another place another day. We've seen that happen in the scripture, and we're seeing it happen right now. Love them, bless them, encourage them. They have a really hard job. They're doing things I could never do in a million years. Maybe God will raise me up. I don't know. They're doing a really big job, but sometimes it just doesn't seem right. I just know that is not right. The best people, they make mistakes too. Another one I wanted to shoot on is one called circular reasoning. This is a really, really interesting thought about circular reasoning. Now, here's an illustration of circular reasoning, where a young lady is in a museum. So the little girl is in the museum, and the director is giving the display and the show and everything and showing everybody what's going on. And she asks, how do you know how old the bones are? How do you know how old the fossils are? You said they're millions or whatever years old, because they always have a different gigantic number that never match anything else. Amazing. But then she's like, well, how do you know how old the bones are? And he says, well, we know because of the dirt that it's in, the soil, the earth that it's in. And she's like, oh, okay. And it's like, well, that was a quick answer. And like, oh, he answered me and he sounded confident. I guess it's fine. But then it dawned on her, wait a minute. How do you know how old the dirt is? And he says, because of how old the fossils are. And she says, isn't that circular reasoning? And it realized there was no real anchor of absolute truth. Amen. Circular reasoning, all it is any kind of belief system you have that doesn't have an absolute anchor. Okay? And like we heard Brother Hoban talking about, he's saying that when you start to preach evolution, the big problem is, in some ways it seems like it doesn't matter, but in some ways it seems like it does, because now God is not the author of what we believe. He's not the author of our morality. We don't have to answer to him. Now we have to answer to the government that's been preaching to us lies. The same government that gives us all kinds of junk in our food to hurt us, the same government that's giving us junk in our air, the same government that's giving us junk in our water, has been for a long time. This is just plain old facts. You don't believe it? That's because you're in too much symmetry with the people that you're supposed to be wrestling against. But they give us, not only do they give us bad preaching, they got genetically modified preaching that is not good for us spiritually. How are they going to give us a good thing that's from God when they are the enemy of God spiritually? They're giving us a lot of the different bad things, but one of the bad things that they're giving us is evolution, trying to take our allegiance away from the God who made us. They're stealing our allegiance and bringing it to themselves. That's what evolution does. Well, I guess we can listen to them. They're the big guys. And they're the ones raising up everybody in all the main positions. So almost everything they hear is all wrong. Not glorifying God, but glorifying man, who is going to be leading you now. But they are ruling the world in spiritual wickedness. That's who rules the world. So when you go to mainstream situations, even so-called Christian things, even so-called Christian film, Christian music, my dear friends, be careful. Not everything that's called Christian is. Bible says that there's going to be many false preachers. And it was, judging by how much worldliness and how much sin, how much immodesty and how much fornication, how much all kinds of junk that's going on in the church, be really, 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 really careful what you believe. Don't anchor on anything. Okay, this is about anchors. Is God Almighty your anchor? He's worthy of being an anchor. Is the government worthy of being your anchor? Is the Pope going to be your anchor? I don't mean to get sassy, but I mean, I'm trying to be plain about this. That's what the scripture says. These are what we wrestle against. Amen. And if it's not the way it is, so circular reasoning, I'm going to give you 5 for evolution and 5 for creation to find out where the real anchor is. One thing that evolution banks on severely is called macroevolution, to see one kind of animal turn into another kind of animal. That is not a fact. That is not a fact. We have never seen it. It's not observed. There's no proof for it at all. Not true. So that's one anchor that they can't use because you can't show it. Forget it. B, no true knowledge of the origins of the earth. So even though you think you might have some evidence to see changes, we know that there are some changes, but they're not outside of kinds, they're inside kinds, and they all have their limitations. That's scientifically factual. So yes, since you don't know the origins of the earth, how do you know that what you believe today matches? How do you know? You don't know. Not an anchor. C, no accurate dating. Dating methods are very new. They're older than me, but I'm not that old. But they're not accurate. If you were to, here's how you could prove it. Take all your different dating methods, take one fossil, all of you date it, and write down what you got, and compare. They won't be the same. Proven, case closed. Not an anchor. Always changing. Okay, see the secularists or the atheists saying, we know we're right because every time we find something new, we just go with that. We know that we are updating our information, so we're not just believing things from the past. We are updating, we are searching, we are testing, we are doing this and that and all this other. And now we know it as, I'm like, whoa, 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 whoa. Your belief is always changing? That just means you know you don't know. That means you can say, well, we said it was fact before, but now we're changing, and now we can't say that's a fact anymore. It's always changing. That's just proof that you know you're not right. Accepting new information and realizing that previous was in error. No kidding. And guess what? Tomorrow you're going to say today you were in error. Welcome to Lie Land. Fourth anchor, not true. Okay. Since it's not true now, they say we are done evolving because of modern technology. Are we going to continue to evolve? What are we going to look like? We were a monkey before. We had a common ancestor with chimpanzees. That's what they say. Or some do. I'm sure they don't agree because they're all crazy. But then they grow into us. Oh, now we're people. And in the Industrial Revolution, we have all these things. We don't have to run so fast. We don't have to do all these things. We're just going to be common, and we're never going to evolve again. And I'm like, in your mind, you're just going to have to explain to people why we aren't evolving again. And you go, oh, back in the Industrial Revolution, we don't evolve anymore. That was just from before that. That is dumb. If it's true, it's going to continue, okay? We're going to continue to adapt, which we will adapt, but it's not evolution, okay? So all 5 of the main anchors of evolution, which is stuff I just even learned this week, I never even heard of it, none of it's a truth. So anything that they believe is all circular reasoning. Just to nail them to the wall. And a lot of Christians, too. They have their anchor. I believe in the Bible. What does that mean? This Bible doesn't save you, okay? If this is your final authority, you might be in trouble because there's a lot of people who say that aren't going to be saved, okay? This book was meant to be a bridge between the human soul and the true and living God, amen? And so if this book has not done its job, then you haven't reached the anchor. God is supposed to be the anchor. We've only had this book for 400, 500, 600 years at best, and most certainly not anywhere near all the languages, but God is sovereign and he's just, and he's got a way to give everybody a chance to give him honor right where they are. Amen. They can. Anybody could have. We haven't even always had papyri. We haven't even had scrolls all the time, but God has always been laying down his judgment against people because they did know. Okay? So just because we didn't always have a written witness doesn't mean that we don't know who God is, because this alone isn't enough, because you still have to come to God. This is almost like a distraction to some people because they're so lettery and not literally in grace with the Lord. They're still natural, or they're still under the law, or they're still and they're not really under grace. Which is the three things you either are. You're either a legalist, or you're under the law in the religion, or you're under the natural, where there's nothing controlling you. Just do whatever you want, whatever you see in your natural state, or you are saved by grace, by the renewing of the Spirit of God. But those two wonderful things, the blood of Jesus Christ and the grace of God, of the Holy Spirit, amen. So we are redeemed by His blood and we are regened by His Holy Spirit, amen. That is a newness of life to give us a brand new vision for life. And when people are born again, all they really want is to just go all the way with the Lord. Creation says five different things as well. The Word of God is our written witness. The world of God, which is what? The world of God is created by God, is our outer witness. Amen. And then the third one, the Word of God, we know that's here. Some people don't believe it's the Word of God, but I still believe that that can be an anchor. It could also not be one, so that's not 100%. So if someone says that's circular reasoning, then that's a good argument. Yeah, it is circular reasoning. But world of God, outer witness. All the creation declares His glory. The heavens declare the glories of God. The heavens declare the glory of God. Amen. So we have the outer witness, we have the written witness, and we also have the inner witness, the Spirit of God reaching our conscience. So God can get to us here with no books around, no teachers around. All of creation declares His glory. The eternity has been written on our hearts. We can know that everybody's been given a measure of faith and they can just come to God as He is, plain and simple. We all have the same stuff around us. We all have the same opportunities to either come to God or get caught up in the things of the world because it seems easy and fun. The fourth thing about creation is that God is never changing. The natural laws that He set in motion are just the same. Natural laws are always, all of physics and all of astronomy, it is what it is. It's never going to change. All the laws of nature are exactly what they are. They're never going to change. They're never changing. That's an anchor of what we see in creation. Since it is true, we keep evolving away from God. The last day's great falling away, that is also something we've seen. His creation rejecting Him constantly. It got so bad that Jesus had to come Himself, and it said He came to His own, and His own received Him not. So we recognize that is an evolution for the church of the creation is here. They could either turn to Him in a true way or a legalistic way or a liberal way, believe in Him and not even let Him affect your life. But there's a form of turning away from Him. Since it is true, we keep evolving away from God, who is true. The last day is great falling away. Okay? I got a few quotes here that I wanted to touch on because I thought they were really good. Ran into maybe 8 or so, and I'll just read them over real quick and then we'll be done. But these are some of the giants, and none of these people are alive right now. And then one more thought I had at the end here. That very church that the world likes best is sure to be that which is abhorred by God. And that's Spurgeon, which I already mentioned that, which we got into, where people are talking, where it's all flipped backwards, and God gets nothing for what people are calling themselves God's people, but they're not doing what He wants, which we see in the scripture. That's not something good. It's like a show of them following not, or turning away from following the Lord, is what it said in the scripture. This one's from William C. Burns. Never heard of him, but this quote is powerful. I like it a lot. Oh, how can the Lord's people be so easily persuaded to go away empty instead of wrestling with God to pour out His Spirit? That's pretty powerful to think about that. Amen. So, never let the means of worship eclipse the object of worship. Okay, that's David Ravenhill. That's Ravenhill's son. Never let the means of worship eclipse the object of worship. Maybe like your instrument or maybe your gifting or anything like that. Never let those things. Your worship of God needs to be first, never something else. There's another one from David Ravenhill that is really, really good. So it's so short and so simple. And actually, I'm going to go with this as the main key tonight, even though it's not something I got, but I read it and I thought it was good. 5 words. We never graduate from dependency. We never graduate from dependency. And oftentimes, like, probably the best example of that would be Uzziah. In the year King Uzziah died, it says that the Lord lifted him up. It said that the Lord raised him up. But his heart was lifted up in pride. It didn't say pride, but you know that's what it meant. The context was really clear. And so he wasn't depending on God the same as he was before. So the rule of thumb here, which is David Ravenhill, he read a really good book called Keeping the Anointing or something like that. Because I think it's something about keeping the anointing. He says it's very, very difficult to get a real anointing and to actually keep the true anointing. And he was showing you the tricks about how to do that. I believe that's a big key in there. We never graduate from depending on God. Amen. We never can ever say, I don't need you anymore. Thank you for getting me to the pinnacle. Now let's just take off. No, God is the anchor. Always will be. Always was and never will stop being the anchor. Amen. Here's one from David Ravenhill. One more from him. Nothing is more likely to lead to error or heresy than to focus on a part rather than the whole. That's a key that we always lay here. I always say, hey, take a chunk from the book, but continue to read the whole thing. Make sure you're getting the whole counsel of God to make sure that you're not just taking some little verse over here that, yeah, the Bible says. Well, the whole Bible says something else that kind of gives you better perspective of what that really means. Amen. So that's true. It says that nothing is more likely to lead to error or heresy than to focus on just portions of it at a time, which is very normal among the body of Christ. That once again, and try to question about, they don't know. They don't know the whole verse, the whole chapter, or the whole context. T. Austin Sparks. I think he's one of the guys that was actually in the revival hymn, one of the things that I first heard that ever spoke the language of my own conversion. T. Austin Sparks. We must remember that the Holy Spirit can never have free course in us and through us if we harbor unloving thoughts concerning other of God's children. You guys catch that one? We must remember that the Holy Spirit can never have free course in us and through us if we harbor unloving thoughts concerning other of God's children. So if we're thinking mean thoughts about brothers in your church, there will never be a real wind of the Holy Spirit for you to see further than you are. Never have the real blessed assurance and union that we all love to experience. Amen. Another one from T. Austin Sparks. The greatest need of the times is a movement of God to bring His people to know the fullness of Christ. Amen. To know the fullness of Christ. The greatest need is that we need the fullness of Christ. We need God to bring a movement like that. There are no lessons so useful as those learned in the school of affliction. Amen. As we know that we can be on the mountaintop with the Lord, and boy, it just looks great and everything seems great, but we don't learn there. We love there and we learn down here in the valley. We learn in places of extreme pressure to our body or our soul's pressure, as a lot of us, you know, I'm going through one right now, but, you know, God is blessing me through it, and it's been a really good chance to be faithful to the Lord here. That's those ones here. Let me check one more thing here to help us get a quick end thought on the gospel. I said that it needs to be explainable and unexplainable at the same time. Letter, invisible works of the Holy Ghost. Oh, we want the letters of the Scripture, the Logos, and we also want the invisible works of the Holy Ghost. We want Christ's righteousness, not our own righteousness. And we want to be forever blessed and not forever judged. Amen. So the gospel that we follow is explained in letter, but it's also experiential. And it's just like this unexplainable miracle happens to us that we are born again of the Spirit of the Almighty God, the unseen God bringing His unfailing love, amen, to His people. And this is what He's got for all people. So you see me getting tense about some things tonight, so forgive me, YouTube. And online brothers and sisters, it's really, really serious. And I know that I don't go as crazy as some people do. I'm just trying to really guard myself from going a little bit, from not, you know, I could go crazy, because that's what I really want to do, you know. It's like, I try to talk calm, but really I'm saying this is serious, serious, serious business. And we gotta lean here where the love of God is manifest in our life. Clear vision. So we don't let the enemy of the church tell us how to be the church. That's not how we do it, amen. We don't listen to the opponents to tell us, and they ought to concern us, amen. Those are a few different things we learned today. Joshua 22, finish the whole story, make sure that the story is correct. But those three different groups, Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh, people of them. If the Lord's enemies are, is the Lord's enemies your enemies? Is the people who are saying things that is contrary to His ways offend you? I hope so. That you want to stand in love, to be true of true light for Jesus. We don't want the light to go out. We don't want to be like people who will exalt themselves, and when truth comes and brings them down, they don't want to come down. They'll just stay there and slander everybody else in order that no one can ever think that they were wrong ever. That's not humble. Circular reasoning. The only way you can not have circular reasoning. So people try to bring that to you. Oh, you're circular reasoning. You don't have any proof for the Bible. Well, you don't have any proof for what you believe in either. And the only anchor is God himself. Those things that were always here, that we people were always here, and God was always here. As far as creation goes, there was always a person there, and there was always God. Those things were always there. Nothing else was. So whenever you want to point at other things, sorry, they're not an anchor. That had to be for everybody. Otherwise, it wouldn't be very fair, would it? So God has always been there, and he is the one. The Bible says that God, our Savior, our the Lord is salvation. Amen. The Lord is salvation. So it's not right to say it's here, there, and all the other places. Yes, we've got the Word of God, and it is true. It is very, very good. It's spiritual. It'll help us to get spiritually right with God. But we are people that want to continue to grow. Amen. So circular reasoning doesn't happen. It doesn't count. It's if people try to use that against you, one good point for Christians. If people say, "Oh, you're using circular reasoning," are you not doing the same thing? Where are we differing here? Just different views and same principles of this is what I believe, so this is for therefore what I believe too. Doesn't matter. Truth is that we want to go all the way with the Lord and be in his grace. The natural man receiving not the things of the Spirit, and the legalists, they don't understand it either. They'll always be against the church. Watch out for them. And remember, the people that are talking sometimes against the church the most, they might be God's next guy. Amen. Don't give up on people because they're talking crazy. Just know that they're not right, but discern how to handle it properly. And if you have to lay the hammer down once in a while, like I did this week, it's not fun. It's not easy, but you got to do it. Otherwise, evil will take over that which has been built up in the Lord. You know, we got to protect it. You know, John Wesley did it to over 800 men for his own group and said, "Hey, look, this is not working out. We need to preserve something here. And if you come in here and you won't be willing to make the adjustments that everybody else had to make, it's not going to work. You're going to ruin what we got here, and this means more." And they were strong, and they conquered mightily. They did mighty great things for the Lord. Great preachers, great songwriters, great saints, great sacrificers, great missionaries, and great helpers in the church. Anybody who cares about what God wants, and they hear the truth, and they respond there, they say, "Lord, I'm in for whatever position you've got for me, whether I'm recognized by people or not. You will make it plain to me where I need to be." And that's our attitude. That's the church's attitude. That'll keep us all at peace with one another. And right there, my dear friend, that's 90%. That's like 80% of all the warfare that we need. Stay in love with the church. And remember, Lord, keep us bold. Keep us solid. Don't let the enemy in our souls. Keep our camp clean so we can advance and take down more. So we're going to influence the world for your kingdom as opposed to that kingdom influencing your bride. Amen. Heavenly Father, we glorify your name because you alone are worthy. We thank you for the word tonight, Lord God. We thank you for your Bible. We thank you that your word is true and that we can anchor ourselves in you. And now that we're born again, we know what book is real. We know that you have authorized your word that is infallible. And we do put our whole hope in you and your word, Lord God, and your glorious leading by your Holy Spirit. Lord God, I pray for anybody that's falling away from you and is getting beat down by the devil. Lord God, that you would revive them by your love, ravish them with your kindness, Lord God, overthrow them with your gentleness, come in your power and your sweetness, and let them know that you love them and that you haven't given up on them, and that they ought not give up either. And I pray that you deliver souls, Lord God, save those that are not walking with you at all, those that have slid away, Lord God. I pray that you draw them in by your Holy Spirit. May they weep in their floors until the joy of Jesus come back to their heart and they can sing all the old glorious songs, wonderful words of life, and 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus and the old rugged cross. And let the tears come down their face and the cleansing and have that knowing that nothing is in between their soul and the Savior, thy dear Son. Let us be bonded together in Christian love. Let the worship happen in this place and let it be real. May we fear your name and honor you and glorify you all the days of our life in childlike faith. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Yeah. Amen. Anybody have something they wanted to share before we moved on?
I have a question.
Okay.
Okay, you said the invisible works of the Holy Spirit. What did you mean with that?
Okay, well, that's half. Open those up real quick.
Here. What?
You gotta share.
Oh, in here? It's in here somewhere?
Yeah. Here, let me send it real quick.
Sorry.
So yeah, the invisible works of the Holy Spirit is something that we want to see. That, you know, as we go back, you'll look in your life, you know, and you will see the changes that the Lord has done in your life. Sometimes you don't notice it, but when you go, you can just look back at your own life and you realize things have changed. There's noticeable changes in some people. Amen.
Yeah.
So that or anything that you know that's being dealt or places of the Lord is dealing with you, little tiny things, which is really good. I really like Christians to focus on the tiny things, but tiny little details of the Lord, though, I think the Lord is dealing with me, or big things, which is even greater, because then you really conquer a lot of ground. But then the benefit is just incredible, you know, such a great new establishing in the Lord. So invisible works of the Holy Spirit, just something that is not visible, something that you can't just go look at there. There's a test tube that proves it right there. It's something that is so far beyond, you know, the explainable. It's the invisible, the works of the Holy Spirit, you know.
Okay, I understand now.
Yeah, amen.
One more question. Oh, that's okay. What is to you the greatest proof that the Bible is true?
Well, like I said, I mean, there is people who specialize in all the scientific details and whatnot, which is really great, and we need that, you know. But for me, my answer to that is that, you know, I had to get real with God myself, because I knew I wasn't right before God, period. And to prove that, I mean, I was influenced by all kinds of people all over the place, that's true, but at the same time, it really did happen to me. You know, the connection actually happened to me, and it was far more precise. It was not really something that I was ever really totally led into. I had to take things from places that I had known, and I never felt like there was anything remotely as definite as what the Lord showed me versus what I've been shown. So my point for saying that is to give no glory to man exclusively, but to say I wanted to get right with God, and I knew I wasn't right. And so, after I was right, I knew what was true. I didn't know about the Bible version issue before, or whatever, but I know when I'm reading truth now, because I know I made connection with God. And so, if He is first, which He has to be, He's before the Bible. Okay, like I said, the Bible wasn't always here, so that doesn't make sense to say that you got to go by the Word, got to go by the Word. That's true, but God is still real, and He takes precedence over. Your Bible is not your ticket to heaven. Amen.
Oh.
It's your right, repented heart before Him, a heart that's yielding to Him.
Yeah, you reminded me of a scripture. Jesus said, if you will want to do God's will, then you shall know of the doctrine, whether I speak of Him or myself.
Amen. Yeah. If any natural creature, you're going to be on the earth, you're natural, you have a choice to look past all this and to the obvious, God is real. No matter where you're born. Now, I believe there are some people who have been born in some severely difficult situations. So in that, if you really wanted to go out with the Lord, it would cost you more. There would be a whole lot more protection for you to help you in that. If people really wanted to search for their Creator. You know, God is always there. People are always here. As long as you're on the planet, you have a chance to get right with God wherever you are in the world. And like you say, or William Brand said, some places it's death. And that sounds worse. And over here, it's massive amount of trickery, which is actually way worse. That's proven in history to be far worse than to be killing people for being Christian. That's clear. People clearly die because they want to be true. Over here, they want to be true, but they're clearly being tricked. And they just don't get it because they're not making the connection. So How do you know the book is true? If you do what God tells you to do, if you keep your heart pure before God, God will make you make it clear what book is real. He'll make you know. I know the book is right, and I know that people take it in the natural, and I know it's not always clear either. I mean, the Lord has to open it up sometimes to make you really know what it really, really means, to really get the full measure, or getting a part of the full measure of God. But God really has to open it up for you. So, like you said, you do God's will. If you really want to get right with God, He will make it plain to you. Now, if you're going to let your offenses or your hurts or anything like that cause you to say, I don't have to focus on whatever reasoning you have, whatever good excuse you have, that would be so much to lose. It'd be too humbling for me. I'd have to lose all my friends. I'd have to... Same door for everybody. And you're not coming in standing up. You're coming in on your knees, so to speak. Amen. It's a humbling place to be dead to your will for His will to come alive. So you do it, yeah, you'll know. That's my best one. Otherwise, you'd have to be getting into things that can be tampered with.
I'm glad that you told me, because I was always going with all the evidence.
Yeah.
Scientific evidence, mm-hmm. which is good, but this is even better.
It is, yeah. Like, you want to go with the rock solid. You want to go with the anchor. If God is real, you want to go with that. He's the anchor of our soul. He's always been there. Nothing else has always been there. You know? Nature has always been there. God's always been there. And we've always been here. Those are the only things we had to work with all the time. Right. If that's not it, if that isn't enough, God's not fair. Amen. Does that make sense?
I just missed it.
Yeah. Well, like, you know, since He created everything, all creation has been here. It's been water separating the air and everything else. God, the earth, its creation's been here. And man was created on the sixth day. And God was always there. So ever since there's been people on the earth, God's always been there. So God's there, creation's here, and people are here. And that's the only thing throughout the whole history of the world that's always been. And if that is not enough, if those three things are not enough for faith to be real, God's not fair. But God is fair. So whether we have Bibles or not, those three things still exist.
Well, for anybody that's honest and reasonable, those three things would be enough.
Yeah. The truth is that nobody on this planet, okay, nobody on the planet has, you know, really, they don't have more access to those three things than anybody else. We all have the exact same access. So that's how God is just and fair. He says, I am fair. Why am I? Oh, I didn't go to Bible school. He said, I know, I protected you from that. I wanted you to know I'm real without having to go get your brain messed up by someone who doesn't know me, you know? And that's what happens a lot of times. Like, you know, people can drift away and give you doctrines that don't help you get to know Jesus. So.
Okay, thank you.
Makes sense.
Yeah. And saying the Bible, my sheep hear my voice, that ought to be even more proof.
Yeah, but if that's not the thing is, if somebody isn't yet a sheep,
yeah,
they think you're insane.
It's different.
Yeah, just listen to the folks. I mean, I've been watching a show. It's really frustrating, but it's actually really, it's good. It's a good way to be frustrated at home and not like in the streets, like arguing with people. But there's a show called The Big Questions, and it's a secularist.
He
goes on there online, and they're asking all kinds of questions, and they go through the audience of a lot of big, big smart people and whatever. And it's really interesting to see. They got Muslims and Christians and some semi-Christians, some Catholics, and just people of all sorts of every flavor of under the sun. They pass the mic back and forth, and it gets a little heated in there.
Yeah.
And I was like, I would like to go in there. That'd be fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There wasn't enough good Christians in there.
I have a DVD of that. One
of
the shows.
Oh, you do?
You bring it in?
No, I got tons online for free, but thank you. No, yeah, I think it has a point. I think it has a place for sure. So when you watch it, you can listen to their arguments, and then you can start to figure out where you can jump in there and start to, you know, dismantle Satan's tricks, because they're everywhere.
He even has Kirk Cameron and Ray Comfort on the show
okay.
You saw that guy, and you just, that ain't Ray Comfort. You just was instantly turned off by him.
Oh,
I just
ran into it. I just run into things as my mind is slowly, you know, it slowly starts to metamorphose. I don't usually jump channels too quickly. I navigate, and when it clicks, it clicks, you know. There's another reason why I'm not forceful with my approach with people anymore. I'm just as happy to talk about lily pads and frogs or trees or whatever with people just so they can relax. Well, where's the truth? God's going to speak to them, and that's what matters most, you know? And
they're not going to feel... If they're an honest seeker, you know for sure that God will reach out to them.
Yeah, and I can wait for those moments. Like, at work, there's people there that I can talk to. I bring up some excruciatingly real talks with them. And I wait for the right moment. And then you just be joking around. Hey, what up, man? And, you know, just clown. I'm very funny and clowny and goofy on my job. And then when it comes time to just like, oh, man, I read this thing the other day. And it was like, what? You know, and bring some bomb and like, whoa. And so... There's a thing, I forgot to mention it, and it's probably fine. This is the discussion part now, so it counts. And I have a tiny bit more grace to talk about it, but whatever. It's a company called Lucius Trust.
Oh, heard of that, yeah.
Lucius Trust is founded by Helena
Blavatsky
and Alice Bailey. And they've written several books together, Alice Bailey's got several books. I've only known about one, The Externalization of the Hierarchy. But there's New Age books, there's meditation books, New Age, telepathy, just really, really weird stuff, and it just goes on like that. And so in London is where their establishment is at, and in their library, they got all these weird books, Jesuitical books, all stuff that's all mystery Babylon, just bad stuff, very anti-Jesus stuff. And so and even on their webpage, it actually says the company used to be called Lucifer Trust.
Yeah.
But because they wanted to be light, we trust. We believe Lucifer is the light. And so they called it Lucifer Trust, but they said, well, because people believe Lucifer is Satan, therefore we can't call it that anymore, we just call it Lucius Trust. But it still means Lucifer Trust. And they are a huge connection to United Nations, who happen to be in the exact same building.
Oh my goodness.
They're together in London, which is like the place that John Todd says, if Satan lives anywhere on the planet, he probably lives in London, because that's one of the worst places in the planet. And there's massive dominion headquarters in the natural and definitely in the spiritual. Where London is probably one of the like wickedest, because all the stuff that we see, oh, ISIS is over here though, what about all the oil spills and blah blah, whatever, yeah, but it all starts somewhere. There's someone moving the joystick around, you know, and it has to start with these gigantic groups, and they are in union. They even says it on their webpage, connected to United Nations, which is exactly what that sounds like. They're uniting all the kings of the nations, so they're the glue of the 10 toes. They're like the foot of the 10 toes. Blending them all together.
Now Obama wants to apply for the job of Secretary General of the United Nations.
And then he would be a part of just about every part. He's a part of almost all the toes. Mm-hmm. Interesting. And being raised up to be a very powerful leader by some of the most powerful people in the world. Hard to believe? Not really, because the book already talks about it. Pretty clear. So, that was something I learned today. Yeah, it's true. It actually says on their own page. I watched it. I was very clear. I watched the videos about it and got to see people, you know, getting a closer look. And it's clear as can be. Their own information. That's all I gave you. Not trying to talk weird behind their back. Well, I am. But that's what's going on. They are real, and they are heavily connected to what the Bible talks about, the 10 toes of the machine, the whole end time machine. Doesn't get any bigger than that. And they even said it. Lucifer. They don't believe in the biblical Lucifer because they don't believe in the Bible. That's wrong to them. It brings up another point. For people who call themselves Christian and you don't believe Lucifer is Satan, don't worry, the Satanists who rule the world agree with you, my backslidden, rebellious, hard-hearted friend. Need to repent. They're the glue of all of them. That's huge. That's huge. You heard it?
Yeah.
And the book, like I always talk about the most, is called Externalization of the Hierarchy. And what that is they are slowly going to show this thing. And so I think it was almost 100 years ago, because she died in like the 30s or 20s or something like that.
You mean Blavatsky?
Bailey. Alice Bailey, yeah. So the book she wrote, that book about externalization of the hierarchy, meaning the hierarchy of the nations is going to be revealed slowly. Slowly externalizing. How many times have you heard people in the mainstream talking about the Illuminati or any of that stuff? How many times have you heard that? Not a lot.
Lots of times.
No, like early in the early 1900s or whatever.
Yeah,
back then, no one knew they existed. And even now, so many people are so like, I don't know, I don't care. And I'm like, that's the enemy. We want to know what they're doing so we can avoid what they're doing, because it might be a problem for our walk in Jesus. Do you have a real walk in Jesus, or do you have a walk in the Jesus that they gave you? Because they gave you one. Sounds like you might have taken it, or you can't decide which side you're going to take, the real thing or the false thing. Is there a cross at your church? Not physically. You should have one, but if you don't, there should be a place for you to die and him to take over once and for all. Okay, that's the attitude of the redeemed. I'm coming to you, God, for real, take it over. I'll start with what I know in my natural, but if you show me more, I will follow you all the days of my life, meaning you're going to be the boss at every moment of my life. That has to be your attitude to come to Jesus. I believe it does. Otherwise, you're going to end up in some little casual thing and never really go anywhere. Whether that's your salvation or not, or just actual growth in your salvation, whether that's a salvation issue or growth in the salvation, I'm not going to get into that, but I can't think of anything else. I think that's pretty much the whole shebang for the week that I had. I think there was a lot of stuff from last week that I didn't get to, but that's no big deal.
Yeah, the FBI can give you the creeps, even though they're doing right, you know, by the laws of stuff. I was talking to these two guys, and they just gave me the creeps. They had the glasses on, and...
Glasses?
Yeah, sunglasses.
Oh, not the sunglasses.
yeah, not the sunglasses. Maybe they're hiding their lizard eyes or something. Who knows?
Okay. We got to the weird side of YouTube all of a sudden.
Yeah.
No, but it is true that the big kids are. They really are. They really are. I mean, if pediatricians are, everybody is. So, anyways, our point is that we want to saturate ourselves with God and His Word and and obedience to Him, so our worship can be true. You know, and like the Bible talks about, leave your gift at the altar. You know, if there's something you need to take care of, then go take care of it so your worship can be real. Amen. So, bringing it back to what it's all about. The house of God is all about God. It's all about His Word, all about worship, all about prayer, and getting surreal for real with God. Because if we don't do it, where are we going to find people who are going to actually get up and go and do something with it, you know? A lot of people are so comfortable in their evangelical churches where nobody evangelizes. And even when they do, is it the gospel of the Bible or is it the gospel of the people that you don't want to talk about? Amen? So, makes sense?
Yeah.
It makes sense, doesn't it? It's like evangelicals that don't evangelize, Protestants that don't protest, the powers that be, which the Bible tells us that's what the Protestant Reformation was all about. Even though they were not the best church ever, but at least they did their job about protesting, which they should. So they call, I'm a Protestant, but you never protest. I'm a skateboarder that never skateboards. I'm a photographer that doesn't own a camera. You know, it's pretty dumb. You know, it's really wrong. And it's like, when are we going to just take a look at where we are? Is this right or not? Or is it, I'm happy, don't bother me with the details. But the details matter to the Holy Spirit. What spirit are you working with? The new version of Holy Spirit that these people have given you? Because it sounds like that could be very well true. I mean, T.D. Jakes is one of the most popular preachers in America. Joel Osteen is. And this other guy named Rob Bell. Okay? All three of these guys are false preachers. Okay? You know why you don't want to hear it? Because you don't want to get rid of your rated R movie collection and your other addictions. Okay? It's the same worldly spirit as your wicked movies. That's why you love the world. And you're not supposed to love it. You love the world. You made yourself an enemy of God. These guys are entertainers. And they're specialists in the field of talking Jesus and living the wrong thing. They all did interviews with, they all do interviews with Oprah Winfrey. One of the very powerful, powerful women in America. Not wise. So I don't know who else she's been doing interviews with, but listen to the words of them and listen to the old preaching. And see if you can't see a difference. You can't see a difference, my dear friend. You better get on your knees somewhere and go out in the middle of nowhere and start howling and begging God to bring revival again. Because we need that old-fashioned, powerful Holy Spirit to put us in our place. To remember us, remind us that we are not in control. Someone's driving. We can either get in God's car or we can get in Satan's car or stay in Satan's car. Because we're not born in God's car. Amen. We're born in a world that's already condemned. Don't condemn me. Not condemning you. Just letting you know the car you're in already, you're born in the car that's not going to heaven. You might want to change cars. I came that you might have life, and that much more abundantly. Not the life that you want here. I came to give you a new heart. Then I'll give you the desires of your heart. A new heart. Because it's going to see Jesus. And all your new heart's going to want to do is glorify him all the way. Old worship. Like Brother Hoban was talking about that old worship. Fanny Crosby, Isaac Watts, and great, great songs from Brother Charles Wesley. My goodness, those songs are powerful. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Let's go ahead and sing. I'd like to sing. We'll just let the camera run out. And God bless you all, friends on YouTube. Thank you for watching. Tell your friends about it. Get serious with God. Amen. Get into the Word. Try to get some things in the Word to share with us. Share it on the comment section, all that stuff. And like I told Brother Kent Hoban, I'm going to write him a new email, because you saw the email that he got before. Well, I'm going to send him another one mentioning about his comment section, because I understand it's getting taken over by, they call them trolls. People just picking on him and saying mean things and filling up his comment section with a bunch of junk, and all the Christians, they can't even fellowship and have fun discussions because it's just mostly taken over by people who don't even care about him. So and someone said, oh, just close down your comment section. And I'm saying, well, don't close it down. Just every time someone breaks the rules, kick them out. Block them. They're done off your page forever. One time. You cuss on my page. Obviously, we don't want that. Cut it off. How are you going to reach the loss? Like this. Stop. You know, it's better than getting to God. Because God's not going to say, well, I'm sorry for hurting your feelings, but you're going to go to hell. You know, it's serious. Okay, I know we live in a very complacent, casual, sarcastic world. I promise you, you will not be complacent and you won't be sarcastic when you see him on the throne. That will be gone. That look on your face will be gone. And the air in your lungs will be gone. The heart beating, that won't be happening either. You're going to know this is for real, and it's going to be over. So if you haven't accepted Jesus, go all the way with God. Are you ready to receive him now? Are you ready to go further with him than you are now? If you already are. Are you willing to do the details that he's trying to deal with you? Are you ready to follow him? Not your Bible, not your groups, not the churches that the enemies gave us, but are you willing to follow him at all costs? That's the question for the church and the sinners as well. And the sinning church especially. That's a really messed up place to get into. Amen. Amen. All right. New guitar is very loud, so brace yourself.
All the way my Savior leads me, whatever. Faith in your word, for I know. love.